Good morning. Happy Saturday. All right. August 28th, prayer for restoration. Lamentations 5, 1 through 22. Lord, remember what has happened to us. See how we have been disgraced. Our inheritance has been turned over to strangers, our homes to foreigners. We are orphaned and fatherless. Our mothers are widowed. We have to pay for water to drink, and even firewood is expensive. Those who pursue us are at our heels. We are exhausted but are given no rest. We submitted to Egypt and Assyria to get enough food to survive. Our ancestors sinned, but they have died, and we are suffering the punishment they deserved. Slaves have now become our masters. There is no one left to rescue us. We hunt for food at the risk of our lives, for violence rules the countryside. The famine has blackened our skin as though baked in an oven. Our enemies rape the women in Jerusalem and the young girls in all the towns of Judah. Our princes are being hanged by their thumbs, and our elders are treated with contempt. Young men are led away to work at millstones, and boys stagger under the heavy loads of wood. The elders no longer sit at the city gates. The young men no longer dance and sing. Joy has left our hearts. Our dancing has turned to mourning. The garlands have fallen from our heads. Weep for us because we have sinned. Our hearts are sick and weary, and our eyes grow dim with tears. For Jerusalem is empty and desolate, a place haunted by jackals. But Lord, you remain the same forever. Your throne continues from generation to generation. Why do you continue to forget us? Why have you abandoned us for so long? Restore us, O Lord, and bring us back to you again. Give us back the joys we once had. Or have you utterly rejected us? Are you angry with us still? Obadiah's prophecy against Edom may have been provoked by Edom's role in the sack of Jerusalem 586 BC. The prophecy of Obadiah, Obadiah 1:1a. This is the vision that the sovereign Lord revealed to Obadiah concerning the land of Edom. Edom's judgment announced, Obadiah 1, 1b through 9. We have heard a message from the Lord that an ambassador was sent to the nations to say, get ready everyone, let's assemble our armies and attack Edom. The Lord says to Edom, I will cut you down to size among the nations. You will be greatly despised. You have been deceived by your own pride because you live in a rock fortress and make your home high in the mountains. Who can ever reach us way up here, you ask boastfully. But even if you soar as high as eagles and build your nest among the stars, I will bring you crashing down, says the Lord. If thieves came at night and robbed you, what a disaster awaits you. They would not take everything. Those who harvest grapes always leave a few for the poor, but your enemies will wipe you out completely. Every nook and cranny of Edom will be searched and looted. Every treasure will be found and taken. All of your allies will turn against you, and they will help chase you from your land. They will promise you peace while plotting to deceive and destroy you. Your trusted friends will set traps for you, and you won't even know about it. At that time, not a single wise person will be left in the whole land of Edom, says the Lord. For on the mountains of Edom, I will destroy everyone who has understanding. The mightiest warriors of Teman will be terrified, and everyone on the mountains of Edom will be cut down in the slaughter. Reasons for Edom's punishment, Obadiah 1:10 through 14. Because of the violence you did to your close relatives in Israel, you will be filled with shame and destroyed forever. When you were invaded, you stood aloof, refusing to help them. Foreign invaders carried off their wealth and cast lots to divide up Jerusalem. But you acted like one of Israel's enemies. You should not have gloated when they exiled your relatives to distant lands. You should not have rejoiced when the people of Judah suffered misfortune. You should not have spoken arrogantly in the terrible time of trouble. You should not have plundered the land of Israel when they were suffering such calamity. You should not have gloated over their destruction when they were suffering such calamity. You should not have seized their wealth when they were suffering such calamity. You should not have stood at the crossroads killing those who tried to escape. You should not have captured the survivors and handed them over in their terrible time of trouble. Edom destroyed, Israel restored. Obadiah 1:15 through 21. The day is near when I, the Lord, will judge all godless nations. As you have done to Israel, so it will be done to you. All your evil deeds will fall back on your own heads. Just as you swallowed up my people on my holy mountain, so you and the surrounding nations will swallow the punishment I pour out on you. Yes, all nations will drink and stagger and disappear from history, but Jerusalem will become a refuge for those who escape, and it will be a holy place. And the people of Israel will come back to reclaim their inheritance. The people of Israel will be a raging fire, and Edom a field of dry stubble. The descendants of Joseph will be a flame roaring across the field, devouring everything. There will be no survivors in Edom. I, the Lord, have spoken. Then my people living in the Negev will occupy the mountains of Edom. Those living in the foothills of Judah will possess the Philistine plains, and take over the fields of Ephraim and Samaria. And the people of Benjamin will occupy the land of Gilead. The exiles of Israel will return to their land and occupy the Phoenician coast as far as Zarephath. The captives from Jerusalem, exiled in the north, will return home and resettle in the towns of the Negev. Those who have been rescued will go up to Mount Zion in Jerusalem to rule over the mountains of Edom, and the Lord himself will be king. Gedaliah governs in Judah. 2 Kings 25, 22 through 26, 586 BC. Then King Nebuchadnezzar appointed Gedaliah, son of Ahikam and grandson of Shaphan, as governor over the people he had left in Judah. When all the army commanders and their men learned that the king of Babylon had appointed Gedaliah as governor, they went to see him at Mizpah. These included Ishmael, son of Nethaniah, Johanan, son of Kareah, Sariah, son of Tanhumeth, the Netophathite, Jezaniah, son of Makathite, and all their men. Gedaliah vowed to them that the Babylonian officials meant no harm. Don't be afraid of them. Live in the land and serve the king of Babylon, and all will go well for you, he promised. But in mid-autumn of that year, Ishmael, son of Nethaniah, and grandson of Elishama, who was a member of the royal family, went to Mizpah with 10 men and killed Gedaliah. He also killed all the Judeans and Babylonians who were with him at Mizpah. Then all the people of Judah, from the least to the greatest, as well as the army commanders, fled in panic in Egypt. They were afraid of what the Babylonians would do to them. Jeremiah 40:7 through 12. The leaders of the Judean military groups in the countryside heard that the king of Babylon had appointed Gedaliah, son of Ahikam, as governor over the poor people who were left behind in Judah, the men, the women, and the children who hadn't been exiled to Babylon. So they went to see Gedaliah in Mizpah. These included Ishmael, son of Nethaniah, Johanan, son of Jonathan, sons of Kareah, Sariah, son of Tanhumeth, and sons of Ephah, the Netophathite, my goodness, Jezaniah, son of Makathite, and all their men. Gedaliah vowed to them that the Babylonians meant them no harm. Don't be afraid to serve them. Live in the land and serve the king of Babylon, and all will go well for you, he promised. As for me, I will stay at Mizpah to represent you before the Babylonians who come to meet with us. Settle in the towns you have taken and live off the land. Harvest the grapes and summer fruits and olives and store them away. When the Judeans in Moab, Ammon, Edom, and the other nearby countries heard that the king of Babylon had left a few people in Judah and that Gedaliah was the governor, they began to return to Judah from the places to which they had fled. They stopped at Mizpah to meet with Gedaliah and went into the Judean countryside to gather a great harvest of grapes and other crops. A plot against Gedaliah, Jeremiah 40, 13 through 16. Soon after this, Johanan, son of Kareah, and other military leaders came to Gedaliah at Mizpah. They said to him, "Did you know that Balas, king of Ammon, has sent Ishmael, son of Nethaniah, to assassinate you?" But Gedaliah refused to believe them. Later, Johanan had a private conference with Gedaliah and volunteered to kill Ishmael secretly. "Why should we let him come and murder you?" Johanan asked. "What will happen then to the Judeans who have returned? Why should a few of us who are still left be scattered and lost?" But Gedaliah said to Johanan, "I forbid you to do anything, any such thing, for you are lying about Ishmael." The murder of Gedaliah, Jeremiah 41, 1 through 18, 586 BC. But in mid-autumn of that year, Ishmael, son of Nethaniah, and grandson of Elishama, who was a member of the royal family, and had been one of the king's high officials, went to Mizpah with 10 men to meet Gedaliah. While they were eating together, Ishmael and his 10 men suddenly jumped up, drew their swords, and killed Gedaliah, whom the king of Babylon had appointed governor. Ishmael also killed all the Judeans and the Babylonian soldiers who were with Gedaliah at Mizpah. The next day, before anyone had heard about Gedaliah's murder, 80 men arrived from Shechem, Shiloh, and Samaria to worship at the temple of the Lord. They had shaved off their beards, torn their clothes, and cut themselves, and had brought along grain offerings and frankincense. Ishmael left Mizpah to meet them, weeping as he went. When he reached them, he said, "Oh, come and see what has happened to Gedaliah." But as soon as they were all inside the town, Ishmael and his men killed all but 10 of them and threw their bodies into a cistern. The other 10 had talked Ishmael into letting them go by promising to bring him their stores of wheat, barley, olive oil, and honey that they had hidden away. The cistern where Ishmael dumped the bodies of the men he murdered was a large one, dug by King Asa when he fortified Mizpah to protect himself against King Baasha of Israel. Ishmael, son of Nethaniah, filled it with corpses. Then Ishmael made captives of the king's daughters and the other people who had been left under Gedaliah's care in Mizpah by Nebuzaradan, the captain of the guard. Taking them with him, he started back toward the town, toward the land of Ammon. But when Johanan, son of Kareah, and all the other military leaders heard about Ishmael's crimes, they took all their men and set out to stop him. They caught up with him at a large pool near Gibeon. The people Ishmael had captured shouted for joy when they saw Johanan and the other military leaders, and all the captives from Mizpah escaped and began to help Johanan. Meanwhile, Ishmael and 8 of his men escaped from Johanan into the land of Ammon. Then Johanan, son of Kareah, and the other military leaders took all the people they had rescued to Gibeon, soldiers, women, children, and court officials whom Ishmael had captured after he killed Gedaliah. They took them to the village of Geruth Kimhan near Bethlehem, where they prepared to leave for Egypt. They were afraid of what the Babylonians would do when they heard that Ishmael had killed Gedaliah, the governor appointed by the Babylonian king. All right, that's it. That felt pretty short. I'm all right with that. It's hot down here. It's humid as all get out. All right. Ooh. All right, you guys. I need to go upstairs and I need to clean up a little bit. My kitchen is a hot mess. I mean, it is a wreck. I need to just clean up a little bit and I need to clean up this a little bit. And then I'll be live making something. Something pumpkin today, as well as a pot of chili to get me through the week. So hopefully you'll join me up there for some cooking. If not, I hope to see you back tomorrow for more treadmill devotions. I hope you all have a blessed Saturday. Love you guys. Bye.